Jesus came to liberate us from the kingdom of flesh. And all those who choose to serve this mission along with Jesus, we're not here to help the world celebrate the kingdom of the flesh. We're here to help liberate from the kingdom of flesh. And what is the kingdom of flesh? What is the kingdom of flesh? It's arrogance. It's the arrogance of the body. The arrogance of the body. The idea that we've been able to change what God created us as. Or ultimately, we're in a belief that we're in a contest that will determine what we are. Okay, this is the root of arrogance, that we're in a contest that will determine what we are. Now, the goal of arrogance is to make it impossible to escape arrogance and thereby claim that arrogance isn't arrogant, because it's just proven that perfection isn't perfect. Because if we cannot escape arrogance, that means perfection is not perfect. It's not able to liberate us from arrogance. If it was perfect, we'd certainly be able to be liberated from arrogance. Okay, so everything that arrogance does is designed to move us in the direction of feeling like we're impossibly trapped in arrogance, and there's no way we can get free of it. This is the goal of arrogance. This is why those who are trying to celebrate the kingdom of the flesh act in such bizarre ways, is the logic of arrogance always has as its premise that the way to get free of arrogance is to prove that reality is imperfect, and therefore this will enable us then to win this contest with God, and that we will be perfect and God will be imperfect. So it moves us towards feeling as if everything we do is trying to make us, mesh us more and more and more in arrogance, so we feel like there's no way out, no way out, no way out, no way out. And this would then, we think, win the contest by proving that God isn't perfect, that perfection isn't perfect. And by winning the contest, we've decided, arrogantly decided, when we win this contest, then we get the perfection and God doesn't get the perfection. We've been greater than God. We've triumphed over God. This is the root of our trouble. So this is why people, you see them constantly reinforcing that which makes us feel trapped in arrogance. Constantly reinforcing it. And you wonder, why are they doing this? They're just making the path so much more difficult for themselves. Why are they doing this? This is why. They feel that they're winning by doing this, that this is the winning strategy. So now you see why it's so difficult to reach people in this world. We might think, well, maybe Jesus' mission is just a delusional, because how many have really been liberated? And it's a difficult mission because of what we've just gone over, that arrogance sees the winning strategy as meshing ourselves in arrogance so that we cannot be liberated from it, that we're impossibly entangled in it. And we feel here in this world that this is a winning strategy that will result in our happiness. So of course we're going to resist anything at all which seems to liberate us from arrogance. We feel that's a losing strategy, that God will win and we will lose. So how do you address extravagantly whimsical situation by pointing out that there is no contest? Pointing out that there is no contest. And yet it is so difficult, because we have, as long as we have been in this play of arrogance, we have believed the logic of arrogance that tells us that being ensnared in arrogance to the point where it's impossible to be liberated in any way is the winning strategy, and it's going to result in our everlasting eternal happiness. So of course we're going to be very resistant towards anything that tells us that we can be liberated. We're going to be very resistant, and this is the times that we live in now, where those who are very much believing in the strategy of arrogance is the winning hand, is the winning strategy, is the strategy that leads to our happiness. They're very much in control and powerful in this world right now. And so they mock any talk about liberation from arrogance, liberation from the flesh, which is the play of arrogance. They mock it. They say, you're crazy. It's ridiculous. We can't find our happiness there. That's a losing strategy. But keep in mind, those who are teaching the truth are not talking about a winning and losing strategy. They're saying there is no contest. There is no contest. That's different than being a winner or a loser. It's simply being as one is. And yet this message falls on mostly stones right now. The mind of the world right now is like a stone. And you scatter these seeds of truth and the birds come swoop in and eat them up. Or it's like a very shallow dirt and the plants have nowhere to take root. Because right beneath the superficial interest is a heart of stone, is a mind of stone, stonewalling liberation, thinking that's going to result in their annihilation and their losing. So no matter how much we witness to the truth, there's a great stone in everybody's mind that it's like frozen stubbornness. A stone can represent like extreme stubbornness and resistance, extreme resistance. Now, how do we make our ground fertile so the truth can grow within us? You need to like kind of keep chipping away at the stone, pulverizing the stone bit by bit by bit, and you gradually add soil. You wear away the stubborn resistance. But it can be very time-consuming and difficult to wear away this resistance. It's very easy for us to have this momentary enthusiasm and make it seem like that we're really almost enlightened, but underneath there's this stone of resistance and it doesn't really take root, and we dissipate our lives in this temporary enthusiasm, whereas really we need to have this work ethic. Now, enthusiasm is not a bad thing, as long as it's not temporary, and the hard work, follows. Certainly, you want to remain motivated, but it's easy to, once you've gone through the cycle of enthusiasm and it hit the stone of resistance, and then you feel like, I was almost enlightened, I was growing, but then, I withered. Then you can become very cynical about the situation. But keep in mind that there are those who do exploit this situation without informing you that, very tough, diligent work, severe dedication is required. Severe dedication is required. And there are many that go around saying, I can... easy awareness, easy enlightenment. Sure. Well, like again, you can think that you're starting to grow and I'm getting it, but the roots hit the stone and the plant can't get the nourishment it needs and it withers. This is what Jesus told us in the as he sat in that boat in the Cove of Parables. So we cannot be taken in by that. It could be the start of something. You say, hey, wait a minute, why did I wither? Why did I wither like that? What happened? And I felt I was getting close and then I just lost interest or whatever. Why, you see? And then you can start, dig down and say, wait a minute. Wow, I've got this stubborn resistance. What is this stubborn resistance? Where did that come from? I didn't hear about that. I didn't know about that. So I would say the best friend we have is the friend who tells us that we have to have severe dedication on the path, because that's what it takes. And those who are trying to soft sell that for their own aggrandizement so they can get a huge following of people, teaching enlightenment, getting a huge following of people, they're not doing full disclosure. Okay, this marks the tenor of the times. For instance, in construction industry, the whole thing is now, there's this mindset where everybody wants a superficially slick looking house, style wise, immediate, as fast as possible, for as cheap as possible. So there are those unscrupulous ones who come in and pander to this mindset that's in the world right now. It's a mindset. And they say, absolutely, we'll look at this, we're going to get you this beautiful dream house, and we'll do it so fast and cheap. And they say, wow, okay. And they don't disclose ahead of time what it really involves. The pushing a really dream home from beginning to the end is a lot of work for everybody, for the homeowner, those who want it, for the builder, for everybody involved. It's a very involved situation, and it takes longer than you think, and it costs more than you think, and this is the truth of the situation. But nobody wants to hear that right now. Nobody wants to hear that. Nobody wants to hear this. They only want to hear the lies right now, that their happiness will come easy to them, fast and easy. And so it's easy with this mindset in the world right now for those to go around saying, hey, yeah, enlightenment is easy. It's right here, right now. It's easy to get to. Well, again, this has happened over and over again in this world. And during the 60s and 70s, there were all sorts of teachers and gurus that were moving around and promising instant enlightenment, Shaktipat enlightenment, all you got to see the master, the goddess, and boom, you've got it. Well, it's easy to give a temporary enthusiasm, but all of this stuff gradually wears down. Meanwhile, they aggrandize the teacher with all sorts of riches and jet-setting lifestyle and houses everywhere and all this kind of stuff. This is what happens. And same thing is the mindset of the world right now. We understand it's in the building industry. This is exactly what's happening. And those who are honest are finding that they're not getting any work, because they tell people, look, this is going to be hard work. This is going to be very involved. This is really going to take everything you've got if you want a house that will actually last. Instead of just, what they're doing now is getting these houses built real quick and superficially looking good. And then they flip them after several years, they move and they sell them to somebody. And then the headache after about 5 years, that's when all the headaches start popping up in the house. And they find out they have to redo this. And the house is junk inside. The guts of the house are junk. It's all superficially glossy and cheap. Yeah, I went in to buy some lights, and I got some real cheap lights. I said, wow, this is a great deal. I pulled one out of the box, right out of the box, didn't even work at all. Had to throw it away. The other one worked for a little while and then stopped working. And see, this is, but it looked nice, out of the box kind of thing. This is what the mentality of the world right now. And this is ruinous for spiritual truth here. Ruinous, because people get cynical. They get cynical. It's really designed, I think, to produce a cynicism. Because in no way is the path easy. In no way. It's very involved. It's very involved. It's very difficult. Our resistance is very severe. We have believed that failing to get free of arrogance is the strategy for our happiness, that feeling as if it's impossible to get free is the strategy for our success and happiness and eternal life. Okay, this is the way we set the whole thing up, like this, to trick ourselves. So a lot of this, and what happens is in the building industry, all these unscrupulous builders who promised the moon, you know, in order to get the jobs. Well, later on, because everybody finds out, wow, we got ripped off, we got ripped off. Out of course, the homeowner's own greed of trying to get something for nothing and trying to get the builder to work for free, so to speak. And then later they blame it all on all contractors, all builders are, you can't trust them. They're all cheaters, you know, that kind of thing. In other words, cynicism permeates the industry then. Cynicism permeates it. Same thing in a spiritual situation where you have all these fly-by-night spiritual teachers who promise the moon, and then they get all this later on, all these people start saying, hey, you know, it didn't, you know, we didn't get what we were promised. We thought it'd be easy. And now they become very cynical towards anyone who proclaims the truth. They say, ah, you know, another liar, another deceiver. You know, so this is a very bad thing. What's going on in the world? But it's the mentality of the world, the greed of the world, the greed of the flesh, the greed of arrogance. You know, want something. It says, oh no, I can have my cake and eat it too. I can have arrogance and also be happy, eternally happy. I got to win. You know, it's the idea that you have to win. And these homeowners, they think they're winning. You know, they get the lowest bid, they get the house the fastest, they flip it, make $1 million, and they say, hey, we're winning, we're winning, we're winning. So this puts this severe climate of cynicism upon anyone here who speaks up, speaks the truth here. Is you see, and this makes it very difficult. You feel like if you speak up, people will, you know, then blame you. Like, oh, you know, in other words, the fly by night ones, they're gone somewhere, living in their mansion or whatever. And it's the anger gets poured out upon the ones that come after, saying, hey, it's very tough. But again, I would say it's your own fault for. You have to forgive yourself, but realize that you were trying to get something easy and it was on your own arrogance. You didn't understand the play of arrogance. Did not understand the play of arrogance. It must be Wednesday today. Oh, yeah. See, I'm getting the noise right now. That's okay. So the ones who really want to be liberated will be liberated. And the ones who merely we're looking at spiritual path as some way to win, we'll end up being very cynical and bitter. And it's hard to get them going again, but they have no choice. They have to. So hopefully next time they will take a path of, where they are, their own motivation is in control. And they become disciplined and insist that they're the ones who need to continue to do the work, and don't put it on some teacher. Don't put it on some teacher thinking that they have some miraculous ability to just, you know, snap their fingers and you're enlightened like that. Now, can those who are liberated help with motivation? Absolutely. But it's just like getting in shape. Nobody can get in shape for you. They can motivate you to get in shape. But it's like if somebody else is running and getting in shape, how does that get you in shape? It doesn't. But it can motivate you to start doing the work, right? So it's a good thing to get going. Maybe some of these people, teachers, are just trying to motivate us to get going. You know, maybe. And maybe they're unscrupulous, you know. But you get out of it what you put into it. And just realize that our deep, deep habits are based on the belief in winning. And we have believed the winning strategy is to make it impossible to get free of arrogance. And then that will prove that perfection isn't perfect, because if perfection was perfect, it could liberate us from arrogance. But if we can't be liberated, that proves perfection isn't perfect. And in proving that it isn't perfect, we feel that that's winning this contest with God. And therefore then, we end up with this new perfection, the real perfection, and God ends up with nothing. So this little game that we invented with God is very problematical, isn't it? Very problematical for us. Because we then work against our freedom, thinking that that is our freedom. That avoiding freedom is our freedom. This is we got completely upside down and backwards. Right now, it's amazing, the mentality of the world. It's very hard to find anybody who is actually willing to see a project through all the way, and with all the difficulties, and understanding how difficult it's going to be, and is willing to do that. Very, very, very rare, actually, now. Everybody's too busy for that. Everybody's too busy. So they're always looking for the quick fix. Superficial quick fix to make themselves look like that they're winners. Now, there may be some, those who have done the work, and it's time for them to experience the fruits of that, of their labor. And what we can tell them is, others, we can tell them, look, as you go forward in your next cycle, next embodiment, so to speak, next birth, identifying with the flesh, as you continue to identify with the play of arrogance, realize success is possible, but only if you really put in a full effort from start to finish. Stay away from superficiality. What you need to do is get a practice and stick with it, and keep on every day practicing and focusing as much as you can every day. What I've found in this world, indeed, is that in trying to help, people pretend to ask questions, but it's what they're really saying is, look, I'm trying to do what you tell me, but I can't. I'm stuck. Why are they saying that? Because they believe that's the winning strategy. They're not saying it because they're stuck. They're saying it because they believe it's the winning strategy. I mean, I'm saying, well, it's easy to recognize this. I mean, it's not a difficult, complex thing at all. I wouldn't say it's easy. It's simple. It's very simple. It's not complex. And they say, but I can't get it. It's so difficult. I don't know what, you know, because they're engaging in this strategy of pretending that they're stuck and there's no way they can get out. And they believe that is the winning strategy, plain and simple. So this is what my life has been in, just futile, because futile in trying to help. Everyone is looking for the quick fix. Nobody's looking for someone who tells them, look, you have to spend a lifetime of effort, really. Just basically bank on that. And if you do it quicker, great. Wonderful. So it's harvest time now for those who have done the work. It's harvest time. That's the new dispensation. It's harvest time, really. And at harvest time, those who have now finished, been liberated from the kingdom of the flesh, from the logic of arrogance, they then let others know that this is possible. And just count on your next go-round is you're not going to waste any more time chasing after rainbows. You're going to decide to get down to work and get it done. And of course, when you do that, you cannot spend all your time trying to glorify the kingdom of the flesh, which those who are the arrogant ones feel that's what you're supposed to do, because they say this is winning. It helps us win. It helps us remain attached to arrogance. It helps us feel that we're happy with arrogance, and so we're not going to do any attempt to get free of it. So we want you to try and beautify the world, make the world a wonderful place, beautify it. Try to do everything you can to make yourself happy with the kingdom of the flesh, so that we can say that we can't get free of arrogance. It's not possible because we're not even working on it. See, by not even working on it at all is like the best strategy to disclaim, well, we're stuck. I mean, there's no way we can get out. If there was a way we could get out, we would be working on it. But we're not. So that just proves that there's no possibility. And so if we spend all our time, you know, on our beautiful house, beautiful landscaping, beautiful this, beautiful that, try to make the world make the world feel like, oh, I love this place, I want to stay here, this is my home, I want to make it more beautiful, oh, how can I make it more beautiful, this detracts from the spiritual path of focusing on the belief system of arrogance and recognizing and seeing, you know, how is it put together, how are you being trapped. If you spend all your time dusting everything, oh, there's dust, constantly cleaning, constantly, you'll spend your whole life doing that. And then at the end of the life, what happens? The dust will fall on your grave. So let the dust fall here. It's a dusty world. Let the weeds grow. Don't waste your time trying to glorify this world for the idol of arrogance. We're trying to serve the idol of arrogance and its logic, which tells us that losing is winning, that being completely trapped in arrogance is the winning strategy for happiness. And of course, since you don't get the happiness that you really want, arrogance just tells you that you're not yet totally trapped in it, that you need to get yourself even more trapped in it. And so you go along with that, and it still doesn't deliver what your real happiness. So it tells you that, again, you still have some attachment to truth, that you need to be even, you know, even deeper enmeshed in arrogance. So you become even more interested and attached to bodies. The body is the symbol, the chosen symbol of arrogance. The logic of arrogance has chosen the body to be its prime symbol. So you become more and more engrossed in the body. More and more, and arrogance tells you this is winning. The more engrossed you are, the more the arrogance says that the better off you are. And so we have these people are just so engrossed in the body. They're so engrossed in the body. And the logic of arrogance has its markets itself to you in ways that make you think that it's winning, that you need to get it more and more engrossed in the body. Whereas freedom from arrogance, the body becomes just like a shadow, no interest in it. You can see the body's just nothing but a symbol of arrogance. That's all it is. Now, there may be people who don't want to hear this message, but pretty soon they'll find out the terrors of engrossing themselves in the body, thinking it's a winning strategy, and later on they'll say, wow, I don't want to go through that again. And then they'll remember, I remember someone saying that I really need to take the real spiritual path, which requires dedication, a lifetime of dedication. But it is very possible to be liberated from the hell of arrogance, and then they will give us a second thought and a third thought and say, yeah, I don't want to go through this, what we went through. So very harsh arrogance gives very harsh lessons. Being self-conflicted. It feels the only way to get you entirely enmeshed is to keep punishing you, keep torturing you. Because you never seem to actually get entirely enmeshed. And so arrogance is saying, well, we got to do something to get you completely enmeshed, like you never get free. Part of its thing is punishment and torture and terror and death and suffering of all types. It's trying to motivate you, to push you, to say that there's no way you can ever escape from arrogance. And yet it never trusts you. See, arrogance never trusts you because you are free, actually. This very moment, you're actually free. So it never trusts you. Always feels that you need more harsher, greater inducements. It uses both the carrot and the stick. Arrogance uses both the carrot and the stick. It will use beautiful attractiveness, and it will also use brutal intimidation on you, both. It's merciless. The arrogance of, the logic of arrogance is merciless, without mercy on you. What most people pray to God for is they're praying to arrogance, and they're saying, and they split arrogance into good and bad, and they say, God of the good arrogance, please, can you just have the attractiveness to us and not the brutality? Can you leave out the brutality? We're just suffering so bad on the severity. When the brutality comes, they say, I just don't understand. Why is God so harsh, so angry, so punitive, so punishment? This is the imaginary God. We're just speaking to arrogance, our own arrogance, and when we're praying like that. We have to see this. That both the carrot and the stick have to be used. Because nothing works. Neither one works. And in such a situation, we're so desperate to win that we will use any inducement we can come up with and be incredibly brutal to ourselves. Basically, the arrogance says, oh, you don't like this body? Really? It's not attractive enough for you to feel eternally entrapped by it? Okay, well, I'll tell you then what you don't like. Obviously, you don't like the body, so I'm just going to torture it and destroy it in hideous ways. And it's trying to intimidate you. And then it says, next body you have, you better appreciate it. You better engross yourself in it entirely. Otherwise, I'll give even worse punishment to this next body. So we come into this world with this fear, like, wow, if I don't get engrossed in this body, this body's going to be, hideously, treated hideously. So it's fear-based. The whole belief system of arrogance, the logic of arrogance, is fear-based. It's afraid that it's going to fail, it's going to lose to God. And of course the answer is there isn't any contest with God at all. It's all our imagination. But the idea is to get so engrossed in the body that we feel there's no way that we can ever be liberated and realize we're spirit. And that will then prove that reality isn't perfect. And that proves that arrogance was right. To be arrogant is correct. And therefore, it's the new standard of perfection, you see. And the old is proven to be imperfect. And therefore, is nothing. So you might ask, well, what do we do? What do we do about this? Well, just seeing this liberates us from it. We're not stuck anymore by it. We're observing it now. We realize that this is just a strategy we've been trying to employ to ourselves. We're so used to the carrot and the stick, we can't imagine anything other than that. And people are praying to God, oh please God, I want to be engrossed in the body. Please give me a good body so I can be engrossed in it. Please help me. If I don't get engrossed in this body, I'm going to be terribly punished. I'll be thrown into hellfire. I'll be, you know, forever. I just need to, you know. And it's like that. We're just praying to arrogance. Most prayer in this world is only praying to arrogance, hoping there's the good side of arrogance, the carrot side of arrogance, will intervene with the brutal side, you know. And when that doesn't work, then we go to the goddess. We invent an intercessor, and we say, oh, we pray to arrogance, and we say, I hope there's an intercessor that can intercede with this whole situation and get the attractive side of arrogance to help us out, you know, the carrot side. So many people pray to an intercessor to God, that God can't deliver, you know, freedom from this brutality, but there's the goddess can maybe intercede with God and get it, that kind of thing. We're just praying to this, to arrogance. Again, arrogance is a carrot and a stick situation where we're trying to get so engrossed in bodies that we feel that there's no possibility, that we're no way we can ever get free. And then we think that defeats God and that we will have won, and then we get eternal happiness. So when we feel that we just can't quite get engrossed enough, because we can't, we're spirit, we're still spirit, and spirit is already free right now, so we never ever get this feeling of total engrossment. And when we fail, we get very frightened, and that's when this arrogance then applies the brutal side of it and punishes us for our failure. Since we can't fail, I mean since we can't succeed at what we're trying to do, and we're bound to fail, that this is what then brings in the punishment, thinking, well, if we just punish ourselves severely enough, then that will, you know, force us into succeeding. What other card do we have to play? And then we turn to the goddess and say, goddess, which is the engrossing part of the body, we pray, please goddess, help me become totally engrossed in the body, because that's the only way I'm going to escape this brutality, this punishment that will fall upon me if I don't succeed. And then we end up sacrificing stuff to God too. Say, God, look, look how much I'm working on being engrossed in the body. I'm going to give you some really nice something that represents a beautiful body, just to show you the covenant we have, that I'm working, keeping the covenant, and I'm offering it to you, showing that of my willingness to keep working on this. Again, all of this is simply relating to arrogance. Much of the history of this planet has only been involved in relating to arrogance, not relating to God at all. Again, there is no contest with God. God remains absolutely perfect as always. There's no contest at all. There's no winning at all. There's no losing at all. There's no punishment at all from God. God continues to be the everywhereness perfection, which is no place at all. There's no place in reality. You can't find a place. It's the placeless place. And this is where we need to dwell. We need to dwell in no place, the land of no place. Because God supersaturates everywhere equally. Pure spaciousness is everywhere equally. There's no place in pure spaciousness. There's no place to be found. It's all equal. So the placeless place, abide in the placeless place. And then you're untouched. You're untouched. The belief in places is our belief that we can engross ourselves in forgetfulness of reality to such an extent that we can win against God. So we keep thinking our happiness comes from places. We just feel we're not in the right place. If we just were in some other place, we'd be happy. The grass is always greener on the other side. I shouldn't have scratched. I always say hands to hands. So a little lack of discipline there. Grass is always greener. We're always looking for another place. We think we'll be happy if we just find that place. And we're looking to be engrossed in some place. I need to be engrossed. I need to be engrossed in a place so that I don't recognize that everywhere is perfect. I can't not be happy. God is everywhere equally. The ground of being is everywhere equally. Nothing is fixated anywhere. So I'm perfectly free, perfectly happy. And we're desperate to avoid this recognition because we think that this will mean we've lost this contest with God, that God really is perfect. And we think we will have lost. And the wages of losing, which we invented this game, the wages of losing, we say, is annihilation. This is just an imaginary game, like a video game we've just designed, which doesn't have any effect on reality whatsoever, and yet we're claiming if we lose this video game, we're going to be annihilated. Well, that's not true. The annihilation of a little digital avatar is not the annihilation of the player of the game. It's not our annihilation. So as we look at this, it brings up this reaction. You call it the wow reaction. It's a blend. And you can feel it. And there's elation, there's trepidation, there's even some regret. It's like, oh gosh, this is what I've been doing this whole time. What idiocy. I've been brutalizing myself for so long. And we think that arrogance is God. You see, we've been believing that arrogance is God for so long as a motivational tactic. And praying to God, saying, God, help us. How do we get more enmeshed in the flesh and in this world? We even claim this is God's world. Say, God, you made this world, so you must know exactly how to get us enmeshed in it entirely. And of course, it's arrogance that made this world. So we've been praying to the God of arrogance for so long. Do you think God is upset at that? No. God is equally everywhere, as always, undisturbed. Or maybe God has a laugh about it. God sees us exactly as God created us, no different, no different whatsoever. But perhaps we'll have a good chuckle that we've been praying to arrogance as if it were God all this while. Do you think God is jealous? No, no. God's upset? No. In pure freedom, there can only be humor over such ridiculousness. It is funny. We'll have a good laugh about it for sure. So bringing all this up, it's just like work. Like I was out this morning pulling weeds is work. You know, at some point you gotta pull the weeds. I was figuring the drought would do them in, but they still sit there like withered stalks, you know. So yeah, it's work. Doing this is work. Absolutely, it's work. You feel like you're doing work. You're working. You're working on this. So it is. It's work. You go to work. You put on your work clothes. You go to work. This isn't play. It's work. We're working on this. And so be a professional in your work. Be professional about it. And recognize, full stop in the wow, that when you get this wow, it's part of the work. Now, many of us have been brought up in the professional class. I certainly was. And we go to work. Strong work ethic. And you take pride in your work, plain and simple. You take pride in being a professional. Nobody's going to do it for you. If you don't take pride in being professional, then you're not a professional. So you hold yourself to high standards. Nobody can hold you to those high standards. You have to hold yourself to them. You have to care about it. You have to feel it's worth the effort. Now when we go through these full stop in the wow phase, it's because we did good work. And we brought to light some very, very powerful recognition that is just wow. All this while I've been praying to arrogance, thinking it's God. You know, this is a tremendous insight. So of course, this is just a history-shattering insight. So of course you're going to feel wow, some wow about it. This is what the spiritual path is all about. You absolutely will feel the wow as you go along. Because the insights that liberate are so extraordinarily different, opposite to what we believed in. All this while we believe we've been praying to God, and in fact we've been praying to arrogance. All the while we've been praying for an intercessor to God, we find out that's also praying to arrogance. That's another trick of arrogance. So the God of arrogance, the goddess of arrogance. Two sides of one coin. It's the same coin, actually. brought to light the fact that we think that losing is winning, and the way to win is to feel that you've totally lost, that there's no way you can get free of arrogance. And we believe when we reach that point, then we'll automatically have proven ourselves winners, and that we will be the new perfection, and we'll be happy then. This is what our belief system is based on. So we've been striving to become total losers with no chance of ever winning, and then we think that will then prove that we're winners. And we've been treating ourselves brutally, carrot and stick, chasing after beauty in the form of bodies and things and surfaces, and trying to enmesh ourselves in that. This world here is designed to help us get enmeshed in arrogance, enmeshed in losing. That's what this world is for. That's what we made it for. And we think that this is winning. We think that the promotion of glamour is helping us win by meshing us in the glamour of the body. So all those who serve glamour are seen as, you know, super important now in this world, because we think that they're going to provide the winning strategy, that they're providing the winning strategy by beautifying and enhancing the body and the body culture, so that we get ever more engrossed in it, throwing all sorts of entertainment up around it. And so those who are very sophisticated and very at doing this, at cultivating fashion, glamour, and all that, they're now they're seen as very important now, as being essential for our winning strategy. And those who downplay glamour and believe in a very strict restrictions against glamour, they're seen as providing a losing strategy for us in the world. So this is upside down and backwards. Most religions were, you know, came about through the grace of God, and pointed out what the true winning strategy was. And all these religions severely limit the glamorization of the body and take great steps to prevent it. Now, throughout the ages, confusion arises, and since we're so enmeshed in the belief that losing is winning, we're not able to clearly see the vision of what the religions are based on, and so it gets pragmatically distorted in ways. But still, you can see at the root of it that there is this very strong prohibition against glamorizing the body. And the language reflects it too. The language, our habits, our dress, our fashion, our language, everything reflects, is supposed to reflect this disinterest in the body, deglamorization of the body. The body, again, is the chosen symbol of arrogance to promote this feeling that we're permanently enmeshed in arrogance and losing and can never get free. And then that will prove that perfection cannot liberate us, and therefore perfection isn't perfect. You see? So we want to be like totally imprisoned. We want to put ourselves in a prison so severe, super maximum prison so severe, that perfection can never liberate us from it. And then once we achieve that, we think this will prove we're greater than perfection. The perfection is actually imperfect. And us being the ones that have proven it, then this proves that we're superior to perfection. You see, we're superior to God. So the price we pay for this crazy idea of trying to be greater than God is to try and imprison ourselves so that we can never be liberated by perfection. This is the price that we pay. And this is what we're actually pursuing, as if this were a winning strategy. So glamour is that which imprisons us, so to speak, engrosses us in forgetfulness of reality. So I wore a simple work shirt today to reinforce the realization that we have to work on this craziness, that thinking that losing is winning. And how do we do that? By recognizing there's no contest at all taking place. There's never been. This has all been a tempest in a teapot. It's all just been a play of our own imagination, conjuring up this imaginary contest with imaginary consequences. And that real liberation is into no place at all. It's not into some nice place. It's into no place. No placeness. So it's not nice placeness. It's no placeness that's liberation. Now, we're not trying to be iconoclastic. We understand the continuity fear, and so we're not trying to claim that there isn't any faint hint of attractiveness, a reminder of in this world, because we cannot create anything, even our imagination, without it having some tinge that reminds us of ourselves. It's impossible. So we're not trying to be negative or destructive towards the world. We're trying to be wise about it. You know how children will be playing an imaginary game in a sandbox, and they'll be pouring sand and saying, okay, this is a castle, and they pour sand over here, another castle, then I'm moving the sand over here, and then they start crying, they're so upset, and the parents say, well, what's wrong? All my people got destroyed, my castle got destroyed, I'm in terrible destruction, the child's like this. Because it's all their imagination. They think that they've lost, you know, in their imaginary game. There was a winner and a loser, and they're, you know, just so frightened. And the parents say, "Okay, don't worry, you'll forget about it in a little while." But they keep playing more sophisticated games. But it shows in our imagination, we conjure up this game of winners and losers, and this has taken us over. You know, it's like a dream. We feel like falling into a dream, where we feel the consequences of the dream are so severe we can't afford to wake up until we win in the dream. We have to be a winner. The dream sets up the scenario of how to win. And so we feel if we don't win, we're going to be annihilated. No, what will happen is we'll wake up and realize it was all a dream. A dream of no consequence. A dream of no consequence. So when your mind starts to wander a little bit, it means you're in the wow phase. You're in the wow phase. So recognize that and bring yourself back into conscious engagement with the wow phase. This is how to deal with this, your mind starting to wander. When you're in the flipping the script phase, you feel you're able to focus in on this and keep clarifying and asserting the truth. And then you feel the wow phase come up and you're in it for a while, and then you may seem to be sort of feel drifting off. You need to pull yourself back to and recognize it. This is the work. The work, it's work, it's work, it's work, it's work. The path of no path is work. The path to no place is work. It's the path to no place, okay, that we're engaged on. No place at all. This is where I dwell. I dwell in no place, Arizona, USA. No placeville, USA. No place. Where's your where do you live? No placeville. I dwell in no placeville. I dwell in no placeville. Yes, I already know that I dwell in no placeville. Yes, I already know that I dwell in no place. My dwelling place is no dwelling place. You cannot view reality as a place. It's no place. It's you cannot view reality as a thing. It's no thing. It's no thing. It's no place. It's no process. It's no time. It's no space. It's no place. So this is where you cannot be touched by arrogance and no place. Now many believe that once that being totally engrossed in the body, making everything here look so attractive, that's winning, and they're engaged in trying to get rid of the brutality, because they say if we just win and become totally engrossed by the false light of the body, that no more brutality will arise, because we will have succeeded and we don't have to brutalize ourselves as motivation anymore. And so we'll enter into this golden age, the golden millennia, where there's no more brutality, no more sickness, all the stuff we do have done to terrorize ourselves into trying to force us to succeed is no longer necessary, because we finally have become completely engrossed in the body, completely forgotten spirit forever, and therefore we have now triumphed over God. And so we're now eternal life, of perfect eternal life. And this is the ideology that keeps us from realizing we're already dwelling in no place. And so it may be symbolized by the light conquering the darkness. But these are just two aspects of arrogance, the carrot and the stick. The carrot symbolized by the light, the stick symbolized by the darkness. And these are, we're trying to be engrossed by the false light, and we use the darkness to scare us, terrorize us into becoming engrossed, you know, completely engrossed in the false light of symbols of the body of arrogance, forgetfulness of reality. So, this is folly, and this is what I've seen, that there's this mad rush in the world right now to complete this triumph over so-called darkness by so-called light. And this is a dualistic deception of arrogance, actually. And this is what distracts us from realizing that we're already dwelling in no place at all. We're dwelling in the everywhereness. We're dwelling in the godness, actually. We're dwelling in the godness. And so this is the main distraction, is this fight against, you know, good and bad, fight the struggle between good and bad. This is a dream. Didn't they say Adam and Eve fell into a deep sleep of dreaming of good and evil? That's right, it's arrogance. That's the dream of arrogance. What does the apple represent? The body. The senses, the body, sensuality, flesh, carnal existence. It's the symbol of arrogance, actually. It's the symbol of arrogance. So once we are focusing on the glamour, which is what Eve represents, the glamour, glamorizing the body, then we will certainly will be in this very deep sleep of arrogance, and our objective will be try to have this false light of glamour triumph over the dark light of brutal punishment and misfortune. Misfortune strikes everyone here, does it? It seems to be, right? I have a friend who I just found out that they I don't want to identify who it is, but they the means to make a living, all their tools, everything was just stolen from them. And you know, they don't have, you know, they would. It's just a terrible misfortune striking them, upon them. You know, it's like a craftsman losing all their tools. A robber stole it all in the night. You know, good guy, but it just shows us that misfortune strikes us severely. And we can go one of two ways with this. We can repent and say, the reason I'm suffering this misfortune is this dream of arrogance that I'm trying to motivate myself to become engrossed in glamour, thinking that that's the winning strategy for me. And I need to turn to truth consciousness. You can represent truth consciousness in various ways. You can say, Jesus certainly was an example of truth consciousness in this world. So we can say we turn to Jesus and ask for help, turn to the Holy Spirit and say, help free me from this dream of good and evil, this dream of arrogance, this dream of trying to win by losing. I don't need to win. And if I don't need to win, I certainly don't need this losing, the fear of losing and punishing myself for not winning. I don't need that. There is no fear of loss. So I don't need to win. Certainly then don't need to punish myself for not winning. And this is how misfortune will then vanish from our lives. We're no longer within the horror of arrogance. So you might say, well, why is there the dance, all the suffering and misery in the world? Well, now we know why. It's we're motivating ourselves. Arrogance is motivating us to be total losers. And until we reach total loserhood, arrogance continues to brutalize us. And the truth is, we never reach total loserhood. So what do you do? You set down arrogance and say that there is no contest. There is nothing to win, no prize to win. We already dwell in no placeville. In other words, the everywhereness. We always already dwell in nowhere. Nowhere at all. No place at all. In God, there's no place at all. There's only God. There's nothing you can identify as a place, because God is equally everywhere. There's no way you can say, well, I'm here, where I am, I'm in God. And being in God, you're sharing in the everywhereness. You're experiencing the quality of everywhereness, timelessness. There's no when to it. There's no when or where to it. I live in no place and no time whatsoever. The timeless, placeless place. I'm dwelling in the timeless, placeless place, where arrogance cannot reach me. So what I've been doing is I'm gradually eroding the distractions. I had an experience of dwelling in the non-dual reality, the placeless, timeless, no place, the placeless, timeless place, and I tried to stay there, so to speak. I tried to keep dwelling, abiding in it, but I found, I heard all these people running past, so to speak, this minds, this interest, attention, and they were shouting and pointing in the distance, and I realized that was the future. And they were all saying, wow, look at this, and I looked where they were going, and there was this play of light. This light was playing, and it was dancing with this darkness, and it was trying to overcome the darkness. And all these minds, their attention was rushing towards into this future, where they felt that they were going to experience true happiness. And here I was abiding in the placeless, timeless place, in bliss and in peace and serenity. And yet, all this attention of so many spirits pulled me out of this awareness of the timeless, placeless place. So it's the interest in the future here which is the problem. It's the belief that the light is going to conquer the darkness that's the problem. This is the Manichaean duality, which is the duality of arrogance, which permeated the history of this planet. Permeated. We've been engrossed in it. We've been engrossed in duality here. And there have been non-dual teachers, but the problem is we pick and choose from what they say, and then we claim, oh, they were really dualistic teachers all along. Because so you just distort, pick and choose, take out of context, distort what they say, and say, oh yeah, they were just saying what I'm engaged in. I mean, the light needs to triumph over darkness. We need to beautify this world, glamorize it and everything. And yeah, that's what they were saying. Or we just forget them and ignore them. Like, I don't understand what they're saying. I mean, so they're not really helping me at all. And this is the trouble. So we continue on here like this. Hearing this. So I had this experience. I understand what's keeping me from dwelling in the timeless place, no place place. The timeless no place place is this tremendous fanatical hope for the future here. And it's really a hopeless hope. It's a hope that we can lose so completely that we'll win, that ends up being winning. And of course, this never takes place. Even if we could lose completely, that can never be winning. And the fact is, we can't lose completely. It's impossible. So this is a futile strategy from the very beginning. Completely futile strategy. It's never had an iota of possibility that would ever work. No chance. And there's no chance now that it'll ever work. So we simply have all this hope in a futile strategy. And the problem is the minds that are in this world now are engrossed in this future of pursuing a futile strategy, thinking, hoping that they'll finally be able to bring such a glamorous world about that we'll completely forget spirit, and not only forget it, but will be incapable of ever going back to it, permanently disinterested in it. And then we will claim that this is winning because we've proven that perfection isn't perfect, because perfection couldn't prevent us from separating from it. You see? So we think once we achieve full separation, this will prove that perfection isn't perfect. That means, and then we can then claim that we're perfect. See, because the idea of that perfection is up for grabs now, and that we have, by pointing out how that the imperfection of God, this proves that we're superior, so we must be perfect. We just define ourselves as perfect. We'll just say, okay, out of our arrogance, we'll say, okay, we are now perfect because we pointed out, prove that God isn't perfect. This is the goal that they're pursuing. This is the goal that the mentality of this world is pursuing right now, obviously. So it's quite difficult. I've found it quite difficult to recognize that I'm in the timeless, placeless place. Because there's just this gold rush fever going on for the future, you know. And we live in California here, where it was first founded by, you know, Indians. Secondly, it was founded by the Spanish rancheros, vast cattle ranches here. And then it was the Spanish missions that were established here. But in terms of actually, you know, population-wise, you could say it was the gold rush that founded California, in terms of the modern California, the way that it is now, was founded on the gold rush. And what was that, Jim Marshall found gold in Sutter's Mill and something like that, and some river. I actually visited this river up in the mountains, the Sierra foothills, where gold was first discovered. It was in Sutter's Mill. I think there was a mill that Sutter was using, and they began to find placer deposits in the rivers of gold. And then information began getting out, and they began to find more and more gold, and people began coming up here and looking. They found it in a lot of, you know, deposits in gravel where the rivers had gone, and the gold is heavy. It sunk down into these deposits of gravel, and then were lodged there. Okay, and so you dug down through the gravel, you threw it in a sluice box, you ran some stream of water through it, and it washed away the gravel and the dirt, and the gold was, they had ways of catching the gold in the sluice box, whether with mercury or various traps. And they began discovering, you know, there was a lot of gold in these hills, a lot of gold, that through millions and hundreds of millions of years, maybe billions of years, have been washing out of the Sierra Mountains. There's tremendous quartz deposits of gold deep in the Sierra Mountains. There still is. There's a mother load of gold there, deeply buried in quartz veins. Massive amount of gold, but it's too difficult to get at it, prohibitively difficult. But anyway, that's been washing, some of it's been washing down. All over the world, gold fever struck. It's extraordinary. The history of this world is quite extraordinary, in a bizarre way. But we went from just a sleepy little missions in like Monterey, in Carmel. There's a Carmel mission, there's a Monterey Bay area there. There's like the old Presidio, I think, a military area. And then there's a Presidio up in San Francisco. These were just little sleepy Spanish outposts. And people started sailing into San Francisco Harbor and docking, jumping off the boats, finding a mule or a donkey or a horse or something, and just making a beeline across the Sacramento Valley to the mountains. That's it. They jump off the ship and head for the hills, just like that. And eventually they came streaming back from the hills with some gold and wanting to buy things. So commerce began getting set up in San Francisco. And gradually San Francisco became this booming, booming gold rush city. People came from all over the world. They came across land in America, up from South America, Latin America, across. They, from the east, they came to San Francisco, and then they came on ships from Europe, from Australia, from all over the world. People flooded into California trying to make their millions. You know who actually made their millions? The people selling equipment to the miners and made their millions. Levi Strauss. The new football, 49ers football stadium, is named Levi Stadium. That's after Levi Strauss, who supplied dungarees. Levi's jeans started in San Francisco supplying the miners, gold miners, who didn't have any clothing. The, you know, the clothing got ruined doing the, you know, digging in the gravel and the tough work of gold mining. So Levi Strauss made these canvas dungarees and was selling them here and started selling, you know, they had a store where people could buy various, you know, equipment and supplies. Those are the people who sold the equipment and supplies, the food, all the various stuff. They're the ones who made their fortunes here off the gold miners. Very few gold miners made a fortune, actually. Brutally tough work. But gold fever gripped the world. Gold fever spread throughout this planet and inflamed the mind. It's the most amazing thing we found out throughout history, that nothing seems to inflame the minds and drive people crazy as much as gold. When gold is discovered, they call it gold fever. And a person will be plowing their field somewhere in Europe or something, and they hear that, you know, massive amounts of gold have been discovered. There's just, all you got to do is dig in the mountains of California, and there's just pure gold there. And they just will drop their plow, leave their family or whatever, and just go. You know, it just causes a craze, absolute craze. Gold is a symbol on this planet, has been from time immemorial, something extremely valuable, because what we're told is extraterrestrials came here mining for gold long ago and developed slaves to did some genetic crosses to develop a humanoid that would be gold miners for them, because they needed gold to stabilize their environment of their planet. So the story goes, and there's certainly massive amount of ancient gold mines in Africa. Very ancient. The story seems to have some credibility to it. And if you've heard the full story, that massive amounts of gold were mined here and then put in these areas that then they would be then taken off of this planet and transported. And this gold was like, the ETs viewed this gold as all important, all valuable. You know, they had to have it for their survival. So humanity has had this history. They grew up around this notion that gold is all valuable. It's the most valuable thing there is. And it's super, super important. So when we find out there's gold somewhere, we just go cuckoo. And of course, it's also very valuable because people value gold so much. If you find it, of course you're going to make a lot of money if you find a lot of gold, and people will want to buy it or do that or steal it from you. So gold fever has gripped this world in a number of times. There's another gold rush up in the Yukon of Alaska area that gripped the world too. Brutal conditions up there. And people can't resist. So there is a new gold fever in the world, which is the millennial notion. The millennial notion, and it's interesting that people are called, the younger generation called millennials. And there's this belief in this golden age is coming, a golden age. And this is gold fever, spiritual gold fever of a different type. The belief in a future, a golden future. And people are inflamed by this notion that somehow the world is going to be perfected. And they're believing in that. And just like all the gold miners in the Sierras, you know, it was a brutal experience for them. Very rough, very tough. Back-breaking labor from dawn to dusk. Shoveling, picking gravel just all day. You know, in icy cold streams, shoveling gravel, and just the work was so tough. And you get a little, you know, gold dust, a few nuggets, and you hope that adds up to something. And it did add up to something. For, you know, you could make a wage, living wage in some ways, but making their fortune, that was quite difficult. That's the big corporations moved it eventually. They made a lot of money through hydraulic engineering of the whole thing, using high pressured water and stuff and blasting the hills to pieces. You can see it up there, the destruction that was wrought upon the mountains and the rivers of California by these barges and dredging barges and hydraulic powerful equipment was just amazing. They literally went through the whole area of California, all the rivers and streams, and just absolutely dug through all that gravel, extracting all, you know, as much gold as possible out of it as fast as possible. So the millennial notion is this dream of a golden age here, where we will become so engrossed in bodies. And, you know, this is what the millennials are all about, isn't it? You know, the foodies, they're so obsessed, self-obsessed with their bodies. With glamour, so obsessed with glamour. So obsessed with glamour. The millennials are so obsessed with glamour. And they believe that this is going to ultimately make them the winners. Because they'll claim that they have succeeded in separating from spirit. They're no longer spirit, they're bodies. And this will prove that reality is imperfect. And then they will be the winners. And they'll be perfectly happy forever. This is severe delusion. This generation is severely deluded. The younger people in this world are, a lot of them, not all of course, but the overall mood of the times is this millennial fever, which is severe delusion, severe arrogance. And it's difficult to witness in such a situation. I feel like, you know, I'd just be mocked or ignored or mocked. Or people say, you're crazy, what do you mean? There's a fortune, you know, we're going to be succeed. And you're crazy, you're going to get left behind and everything. Well, that's gold fever. Gold fever would say, hey, you guys staying here, you're not going to, you're crazy, you're nuts. I'm going to make my fortune, see you later. That kind of thing. So the millennials have succeeded, the younger generations have succeeded in putting their people in power in the world, tearing down all the laws which minimize glamour in the world, which insisted on civil discourse that minimize body thoughts. Instead, they're bringing in all the stuff that keeps emphasizing body thoughts, body thoughts, body thoughts, body thoughts. Marijuana pot is part of this, drugs are part of this, that it induces sensuality, induces body thoughts, and it's all part of the whole millennial delusion. Winning through totally losing, producing total imprisonment as the winning hand. This is what they're after. So they feel that this millennium will enable them to enmesh themselves in the body to such an extent that they will actually separate from reality and therefore prove that God's imperfect and they'll win. So that's the millennium here is really, this golden age is really a belief in that we will finally completely engross ourselves in the body and then in this world. That's what it's really about. So is that a severe indictment of the younger generation? Not speaking in terms of generalizations, yes, but not in particular people in particular, because not everyone of the younger generation believes in this. But it's certainly not an easy thing to pull away from it and say, no, this is false, because like I said, I was pulled out of the non-dual, the timeless, placeless place because of this gold rush fever in the world for the future, thinking, wow, you know, what is everybody so obsessed about? You know, what are the millennials so obsessed about? What is it they think that they think they're winning? They see the winning hand. You say, what do you mean, winning hand? There is no winning hand. There's no contest. How can there be a winning hand if there's no contest? There's no game at all, actually. God's not engaged in any game with us. God doesn't play games with us. He's not engaged in any game at all. And I've found that the millennials, by and large, are impervious, like a stone, you know, to listening. They won't listen. They're like a stone. This is this, you know, shallow soil that's on, and underneath it's stone. And it's mostly the older people, not all, with you know, there's exceptions, but the older people kind of have a more sense of this, like they say, hey, yeah, but they don't have the juice, it seems like, to really, you know, stand up, free or get free, or abide in the timeless, placeless place of right here and right now, as it were. The hereless hereness and the nowless nowness. The placeless place, the timeless time. But maybe this will help everybody. Maybe this will help everybody. Maybe it'll help some of those in millennial generation to wake up and say, wow, I see what I've been pulled along. I don't really want to go along with that. No way. And maybe some of the older people of previous generations will say, yeah, this is what I've known all along. Now I see it in the right context. This is what I'm hoping. I don't know what the mission of Jesus is for how it will go, the new dispensation. I'm not sure. I'm not sure what the harvest will be like now. But certainly we have to be harvested from any interest in the future. You know, future is nothing but arrogance. It's arrogant to believe that there's a future. There's only the perfection of the now. There's no future. But we believe, we have to believe in a future because we believe this, the future is where we'll separate from reality, from now, and defeat God. And so we're seeing this victory. We're seeing this great victory, something that's like really interesting to engage in. That, you know, it's very artistic. We'll use light in so many artistic ways, and you know, all this. We'll create the. And now, of course, there's this movie, what, Tomorrowland by Disney, which is absolutely like clockwork. Here it comes, and they're promoting this like crazy. And this is what the millennials want to see. That's what Disney has determined, of course, that this is what the millennials are all about. Tomorrowland, you know, Tomorrowland. This is the delusion. And of course, there's all these buildings, little, you know, exotic structures and exotic light displays and exotic artwork, and they're into this false light. You know, energy is false light. The solar energy, electromagnetic energy of solar light, all of this energy we're dealing with, that's all false light. Meaning it's an illusion of light. It's light pretending not to be light based on our own desire asking for this. It's light pretending to not be light. It's the living light pretending to be dead light, actually. And so all this clever stuff they can do with this dead light, this illusion of dead light, they think that will win, prove their separation status. And so they're pursuing what they think is a winning strategy. So of course they're all hopeful, and they're all going to get geeked up, and you know, Tomorrowland, this, you know, and this, because they think it's winning. It's winning. No, it's just continuing to stumble along on the trail of tears. Actually, is all it really is. And really bizarre, you know, brutality will rise in all sorts of ways, because the carrot and the stick are still entirely in play, because it's doomed to failure. And so all we can do is punish ourselves, torment ourselves in order to try to drive ourselves into a success which can never be reached. We're already free, and so just dwell in the timeless, placeless place. Dwell on the timeless, placeless place. We're already there. We're always there. How can we not be there? How can we not be in the placeless place, the timeless, placeless place? How can we not be there right now? How is it possible? There's no time and there's no place, so how can we be other than in the timeless, placeless place? How can we be anywhere other than in the timeless, placeless place, which means right here, right now, the timeless, placeless place? It's obviously impossible to be separate from that. There's no place where we can go to be separate from it. We're in the placeless place. There's no time that we can be in to be separate from it because we're in the timeless, placeless place. So, we're going through a phase right now where the millennials, the younger generation, is making their move. Okay? They're making their move. Tomorrowland, end of Tomorrowland. They have their leaders that they want. They have it lined up. They have everything they think going their way. And so they've now entered into this commitment, as it were, to the future, to this gold fever, a millennial gold fever, of what they think is a winning strategy. So this is why in this May we've had this slump here. And Jesus is back now because of this. This is the time where this all this is taking place. The intensity is now here. So what I feel is like once this starts separating out between those who are pursuing this so-called winning strategy, which is nothing but folly, and those who decide, no, I'm going to dwell in the timeless, placeless place, then Jesus can come on the scene and start separating the wheat from the tares, the wheat from the weeds, tares are weeds, the goats from the sheep. You know, the goats are going towards glamour, and the sheep are willing to dwell in the timeless, placeless place, except that that's where they are right now, and therefore can't be anywhere else, right? It's not possible to be separate from that. It's not possible to be separate from timeless placelessness. There isn't any time or place to be separate from it. And so Jesus will then begin the harvest here, new dispensation, the harvest. And some from the younger generation will be part of the harvest because they will have, you know, they'll realize, hey, I don't really want to go in that direction. You know, that the gold, you know, gold fever, millennial fever, I don't want to go there. No, no. And some of the older generations will be part of the harvest too. So right now there's this shock in the world where we realize the harvest is now going to take place and commitments are taking place. And this is a shocking time. And so temporarily, we may feel like in a state of non-spiritual state, like I can't decide, I'm having struggle, I'm not sure. And so you might lose interest. I feel some people have lost interest in this. But that's temporary. It's temporary, so I'm not giving up. It's temporary. I've been able to power through this time and keep going, keep the momentum going. Whereas I realize it's a very difficult time because you realize the time of decision is now upon us. And this millennial gold rush fever, rushing into glamour, is now full blast, full speed ahead. Full speed ahead. They've dropped any pretense of being anything other than that, of arrogant, you know, separationists. They've dropped any pretense. And that's kind of shocking. We realize, wow, it's decision time now, isn't it? We can either do that, or we can go along with the consciousness of truth, Jesus, which is what Jesus tells. Hey, you're already in the timeless, placeless place. Just awaken and realize where you're at. That is where you're at. And so we're at that juncture now of decision time, and that always, it gives us temporary pause. We pause temporarily and just say, wow, it's decision time, wow. So I'm going to keep on pushing with this, keep on pushing it. And we'll see where the interest is in this world. We'll go to where the interest is, wherever it is. are deglamorizing the body, not worshiping the body, not saying how wonderful the body is, not saying how wonderful replication of the flesh is, not saying how wonderful and noble and awesome and important it is, not paying attention to the beautification of the body, paying attention to the showing the beauty of the clothing of the body, the movement of the body, all this stuff, body consciousness, body attraction, deglamorizing all of that, de-emphasizing all of that. There's the purpose of religion. It's very important purpose of religion. That's why they put men, old men, in charge of religion, so to speak, because it's very difficult to, you see, teeth balding, toothless, aging, you know, male bodies ugly, you know, and it's like, I'm not interested in that body, you know. It's very, very unglamorous, that's for sure. And then they even put the priests in dresses, say, well, yeah, we know that you really want a glamorous, you know, women up here, so we'll put up dresses on, but we'll still be unglamorous males, old males, hairy, ugly males, you know. It's like, where's that, you know, sleek, elegant sports car? You know, no, it's just an old rambling pickup truck is all it is. So you put the old rambling pickup trucks in charge of religion. Of course, because the whole purpose is to deglamorize, to attract us away from glamour, which is just arrogance. So of course the right way is to have these elder males serving that purpose. I mean, look at them, you don't feel any glamour. You say, I'm not attractive. There's no attractiveness there. Aging, out of shape, wearing dresses, you know, these robes or whatever, and these heavy robes, is like, there's no glamour there. Then of course the millennials want to put glamorous bodies in all the places of their religion. They say, let's get some young, attractive, glamorous bodies, you know, as in charge of religion. It's time. This is part of millennial fever. They have millennial fever. They want to be glamorized. And of course these old, fuddy-duddy, old, crusty males, you know, keeping the doctrine, you know, and they say, there's nothing glamorous there. How can they help us? They're not glamorous. How can we get enmeshed in glamour entirely so we can separate from reality if they're in charge? We've got to get rid of them. This is the attitude of the world, you know, the attitude of arrogance. Younger generation, millennial, those with millennial fever. And for our older generation, we say, that's fine. It helps us. We don't want to be glamorized. This helps us. If we understand what the goal of deglamorization is about, then we're happy to have these old people, you know, unglamorous people in charge. Don't have any hair to even go to. You can't even go to the hairstylist because they don't even have any hair. Now, there's an old deacon of the Catholic Church, and he came back. He somehow retired, and he came back, and he was talking to somebody in front of me, and I smiled at him, did he shake my hand or something? He reached out to me or something like that. I'd never talked to him, but I just smiled. He's real old, you know, white hair, frail, an old guy. But what a beautiful spirit this old man has, you know, absolutely. You don't feel any glamour in him at all. And I never spoken with him, but he reached over and shook my hand and smiled, you know, and said, yeah, I get it. I get the recognition there. It was the opposite of glamour. So what you're going to do, what you want, is those who are most at ease and not paying any attention to their appearance or the body or glamour. You want those to be in charge. You know, those who it's easy for. You don't want someone who struggles with it to be, you know, in places of authority over in religion. Not at all. I mean, sure, there are people who say, okay, well, I can do that too. I can be unglamorous. I can, and yet you can tell that they're struggling with it. They want to, you know, they say, if I just make myself look beautiful, body beautiful, you know, sometimes can I not dress up a little bit, and you know, and they're struggling with it. One second. Okay, all's well. So you want those who are just naturally disposed, more disposed, and they're at peace with it, and they're saying, yes, this is right. We want them, those of us who need help, we want them to be the stewards, the good shepherds, part of this, you know, helping shepherd, freeing us from arrogance. That's what we want. I don't want any glamorous person up there. I don't even want myself up in a high position, you know, if I'm still stuck in glamour, you know? I want someone who's free of that. Absolutely. And if there's some music, which I don't think there should be, but if there is, then do it in a very unglamorous way. There's a way to do it that's very not drawing attention to the talents of the body, the skills, the talents of the body should be de-emphasized, absolutely de-emphasized. Again, the body is the chosen symbol of arrogance. This whole plan of arrogance to defeat God in an imaginary contest and prove it, and then usurp the position of being prime creator. The body is the chosen symbol of arrogance. Now, in terms of an institution, I want institutions to be stewardship to be in those who are naturally disposed to no glamour, see, less glamour. Absolutely, I do. Now, in terms of each one of us, you know, we need to get free of arrogance, okay? But, you know, when in Rome, do as Romans do. We don't necessarily have to try and artificially try to deglamorize, you know, shave our heads. A lot of people think that shave their heads and they've gotten rid of glamour or something. That's not true. We don't have to disfigure ourselves and say, oh, I'm disfigured, that's great, I'm free of glamour now, or something. Or we don't have to live in poverty and say, look, I'm free of glamour. Those are grandstanding. That's grandstanding. The real practice that frees you from glamour is this practice here, the practice of full stop in the wow, assertions, full stop in the wow, flipping the script. It's your dedication to the spiritual path which really frees you from arrogance. So we're just sitting here talking, right? And there's nothing glamorous about this at all, you know. But we're not trying to grandstand and say, hey, gee, look at us. Let me put ashes on my head, you know. Look how free of glamour I am. Because ultimately getting free of glamour is a spiritual clarity. Okay, it's not just how the body looks, what you've done to mortify the body. Asceticism doesn't free you from glamour, as Buddha found out, right? Trance states don't free you. Mortification of the flesh doesn't free you. Okay, you have to see it, see through it. See through, oh, this is what I've done. Wow, now I see it, you know, and awaken from the dream. If you want an example of someone who is truly free of arrogance, look at Ramana Maharshi, absolutely free of arrogance. You could feel there's no body consciousness there at all in him. The body was just a lump of clay, as far as he was concerned. You know, it's quite extraordinary. Puts us all to shame. You know, it just shows us how still stuck in glamour we are. Arrogance, how stuck in arrogance we are. But, again, self-mortification isn't the way. Wearing a loincloth and like Ramana Maharshi, that's not going to cure us at all. Not at all. So don't obsess over trying to grandstand, you know. Just be severely modest, for sure. Be severely modest. One thing that I do recommend that I've noticed throughout a lifetime here is very important. Wear plain colored clothing if you want to be severely modest. What I found is colorful designs in the clothing automatically attracts our attention to the flesh. Wear loose-fitting, monotone, no-pattern clothing. Is you want to be severely modest? That's a very important step. Because I've just been aware of attention, the play of attention. I've been observing the play of attention in this world. You know, and I see these people, these bodies, wearing, it may seem like simple clothing, not all fancy, but they have all these really ingenious, beautiful designs in their clothing, you know. And my attention is like drawn to that. And it's like, I can see, it's not just my attention, that the attention of the mind is, look at that clever pattern, look at this. Oh, there's a body wearing this. Oh, aren't bodies wonderful, you know. So I've found that go for simple, loose-fitting clothing with no exotic textures or patterns or coloring or stuff like that. It's just monotone, simple monotone clothing. Black is often used. This is just a simple black shirt. It's got a little logo on it from Carhartt, the working clothes. But it's just a simple black shirt. Some churches, services you go to, and you think that everybody there has just been at the beauty salon and have just visited their designer, you know, their fashion designer. And, I mean, they just had a makeover, you know, just like everybody is dolled up, everybody is fancied up. You know, they say, well, I gotta please the Lord. Well, they're trying to please arrogance is what they're trying to do. They're attending a worship service, worshiping arrogance, which is an idol. It's not God. It's the false idol of the false light, which is supposedly to triumph over the so-called brutal aspect of arrogance by proving that they can be completely separate from reality, be completely enmeshed in the body, and therefore they have won. Now, this is the strategy they're going after. Now, you don't have to drop sloppy. Non-glamour is an attitude. It's an attitude. You don't have to be unkept, you know, as you're grooming, because that in itself can be very glamorous, okay? The natural, primitive look, you know. Now, you can be groomed, that's fine. And you can wear new clothes or fresh clothes, whatever, that's fine. But they're, you know, don't have the patterns on them. Get rid of all those, that pattern cleverness, all that cleverness that is really subtly attracting to the body. Subtly. Absolutely it is. Make no mistake about it. I find in church that some people are humble, you know, and severely modest. Absolutely. And others aren't. Absolutely. If you're really going to a service worshiping God, you go there to drop your arrogance in the belief that you could ever be anything other than what you God created you, which is spirit, formless spirit. That you're not a body, you're free, you're still spirit exactly as God created you to be. So there's no clothing that spirit can wear. There's no form to dress up. There's no form to be there dressed or undressed. So undressedness is also a severe form of glamour. there's a way to just de-emphasize the body. There's a way to de-emphasize it, whether it's wearing long sleeves or short sleeves, whether it's an attitude of de-emphasizing the body. It's like your meals too. What are your meals like? De-emphasize the glamour of food, you know, just like, you know, just meat and potatoes are just basic stuff. My food is like really basic, just really basic. Nothing fancy about it. Nothing fancy. And this is all just discipline, a very helpful discipline. Because keep in mind that we're getting free of this. This is the way to get free of the brutality that always follows. Arrogance always has a severely brutal side to it. Always. Arrogance can never free itself from brutality. And again, it keeps insisting it can. It keeps insisting. Well, it says, as soon as I win, then I'll be free of brutality. But it never wins. It never separates itself. We never separate ourselves from reality. So arrogance never wins. So it's always got this brutal, vicious component to it. So we're being severely disciplined and modest because we want to get free of arrogance, because we realize it's always going to attack itself. It's always going to be vicious. Always going to be brutal. You hear all the time, just like my friend who, brutal, losing the means to, you know, for a livelihood. He's got a wife and kids, and you know, insurance companies won't pay you a dime, really. I mean, the stories I hear about insurance companies are brutal. They say, well, you have photographs of all the tools that you lost in the way that you lost them, in a trailer or something. Or do you have proof that all those tools were in there? I mean, who spends their time constantly photographing every last thing, you know, for insurance purposes? Only obsessives do that. And they say, well, we don't know what you had in there. There's no way for us to verify that you lost anything. And even if you did, well, depreciation, all that stuff, how old were you? When did you buy it? Show us the receipts for when you bought every last thing. Oh, you've had it for 3 years, 4 years? Well, it's basically worthless on the market. You can't really sell for anything. It's depreciated. We'll give you a dime on every dollar, basically. You know, but for whatever you can prove you had. I had a friend that, while they were away at work, thieves broke into their house and ransacked the entire house, stole all their jewelry, all their collections of precious collections that they had. They stole everything of value from the house. It was just a massive amount of, you know, money. And the insurance company said, well, you don't have any proof that of what they stole, so we can't give you anything, and you know, it's not even worth trying to do it. This is a fact. Brutal stuff happens all the time here in arrogance. There's no brutality in reality, but there's great brutality in arrogance. And arrogance is always saying, oh, that's just the bad arrogance. That the good arrogance can win against the bad arrogance. No, it can't. It's all one coin. How can one side of a coin win against the other side of a coin? It's one coin. We can never succeed in the goals of arrogance. We can never win a contest with God, because God is not engaged in any contest with us at all. We can never stir God up into a contest with us. It's impossible. So arrogance saying that it can free you from brutality is a lie. It's an absolute lie. Arrogance can't free itself from arrogance at all. It cannot free itself from the dualistic nature of arrogance. Non-dual is not curing arrogance, saying, okay, now I have a non-dual arrogance. That's not possible. That is not the goal. Arrogance is inherently dualistic. So it's setting arrogance down and saying, There is no way to separate from God. There is no contest taking place, God. There's never been any contest. That has to be the realization. There's never been any contest. I never stirred God up into a contest with me in any way. This has to be the realization. I never stirred God up into a contest with me in any way. Spirit, I ask Spirit. Spirit never did. God is absolutely unstirred, unmoved, totally, without any exception. No one has ever stirred God up into a contest. And we've misconstrued so much, and we'll continue to, those who are, you know, very deluded will continue to misconstrue whatever help arrives. They will put it in the wrong context, thinking that this, oh, now here's a way to get rid of the bad side of arrogance, and we get to keep the good side. This is, they looked at Jesus that way. Oh, here's someone, sacrificial lamb to take away the sins, I mean, take away the sins of arrogance, the brutal side of arrogance, by willingly undergoing all the brutality of that, as if God's saying that I'm now willing to, you know, drop, as the God of arrogance saying, I'm somehow willing to drop the brutal side of arrogance, and you can have just the good side of arrogance. This is delusion. It's absolute delusion. As the delusion of duality. You can have one side of the duality and not the other. It's not possible with arrogance. It's not possible. So we're always thinking, how can we get the good side of arrogance? In other words, attraction to bodies, and get rid of the bad side, which is the brutal motivation to keep brutalizing us for our failure to fully engross ourselves so that spirit is no longer spirit, but it's now flesh. And they use Jesus as a symbol to say that spirit became flesh. And to prove it, had to be killed to prove it, you see. In order for Jesus to prove in their eyes that spirit had become flesh, in other words, spirit had now completely engrossed itself in flesh, which they feel is their salvation, that Jesus had to die to prove it. And once Jesus died, they say, oh, okay, now you've proven that spirit had become flesh. So that we've won. We've been able to engross ourselves in flesh to such an extent that spirit can actually die, be killed, which proves it is totally engrossed. And that means then we've won this contest with God. But Jesus had a curveball to throw him, the resurrection. And he said, hey, the death of the body is just an illusion. You can't destroy the body. You can't destroy the spirit. I mean, you cannot destroy that. Destroying the body does not destroy the spirit. Failure. Failure. So the resurrection is just pointing out how we tried to use Jesus is a failure. Fail. Fail. Jesus said, okay, I'll go along with what you want. I'll show you. I'll prove to you. It's a failure. And so when they saw Jesus, what? You know, it's like, what is this? He resurrected from the dead. Holy cow. I mean, no. We killed you. You know, your body, you're dead. Jesus said, no, you killed the body, but you didn't kill the spirit. You can't. The body's nothing. Body profiteth you nothing. Flesh is nothing. That's what Jesus told us. So, yet there are many who still are focused on the crucifixion. In fact, last Sunday was Ascension Day in the Catholic calendar, and they spoke about the ascension of Jesus, and the priest said, how many of you realize this is Ascension Day? What does that mean to you? Do you ever think about it? Or do you only think about the crucifixion? The only thing. And the truth is, most Christians only think about the crucifixion because that they feel that enabled their strategy of arrogance to win. This is the winning way to get arrogance to win. See, most of us have been engrossed in trying to win. That arrogance says there's a winning strategy. And to be completely engrossed, spirit to become flesh is the winning strategy. And Jesus went along with that, and then he said, hey, I'm back. Guess what? Spirit didn't become flesh. Flesh is just an illusion. I never died. Spirit never died. But to tell you this, I resurrected the body just to tell you this, that I'm still alive. See? Because if I was a spirit and telling you this, you wouldn't believe me. But so I had to resurrect the body to tell you, show you that I'm alive. And once you realize this, now I'm going to ascend and, you know, and into a body of light. Light body, actually. So, most people don't focus on the ascension. The ascension was after the resurrection had been shown to so many. He said, okay, now you focus on the resurrection. Okay, I want you to focus on the resurrection. That, and crucifixion is showing the resurrection, you know, the resurrection shows the crucifixion had no effect on spirit. Has no effect, the death of the body has no effect on spirit. Therefore, the goals of arrogance can never be reached. Goals of arrogance can never be reached. Goals of arrogance can never be reached. The goal of arrogance can never be reached. And yet we are still frantically pursuing that goal. To be engrossed in a body. You know, and we thought that the God of arrogance, the good side, we think, sent Jesus to be crucified so it would prove that that spirit was made flesh, and that would prove to us that we can engross ourselves in bodies. But Jesus said, no, 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 you got it wrong. The God that sent me, you don't know the God that sent me. You don't know the God that sent me, actually. You've been worshiping an idol. An idol of death. You've been worshiping an idol of engrossment and the spiritual death. You've been worshiping an idol of spiritual death. You want to bring about spiritual death to prove that you're greater than God. So you tried to bring about my spiritual death, but you failed. And let that failure be a lesson to you. And so real Christians have let that be a lesson unto them. And said, wow, whoa, wait a minute here. I need to re-examine my beliefs. And really, Jesus saying, let this lesson be an ultimate failure to you. You totally failed. Let this be a lesson that you can never succeed at what you're trying to do. You can never succeed at it. So, real Christians are serious and somber, and because they're like got this weight, it's like on their minds, like, hey, this whole strategy I've been pursuing is a born failure. There's no chance it's going to succeed. Wow, I've got to redo my beliefs here. I got to set this down. Wow, this is really a big deal. How in the world am I going to do this? Wow. So they're you know, the real Christians have a different attitude about them. They're like kind of serious and pensive and reflective, because they're trying to understand, you know, how can I set this arrogance down? How can I set it down? I've got to set it down. This strategy is a failure from the very beginning. Arrogance is a liar and a deceiver and a murderer from the very beginning. And let us not personify arrogance. That's a mistake. It's a spiritual logic. It's not a person. It's not a person. It's not Lucifer. It's not Satan. It's not some personification. It is a body, a belief system of logic. The logic of arrogance. The logic of arrogant deviation is this load that we've been carrying around with us. And we have to see through it. To personify it, we think all we have to do is destroy this body of this person and we're free of it. That's magical thinking. That's delusion. You don't destroy arrogance by destroying some body that you say symbolizes it. Well, the logic of arrogance is not a body. It's thoughts, it's thinking, it's belief. You cannot destroy it by destroying some body. It's impossible that way. You destroy it by setting it down and saying, I no longer want to pursue this objective of being greater than God. So you no longer desire to dance this dance. That's it. You stop dancing the dance. You realize that God has never been moved into any dance of arrogance with you, any dance contest with you. It's never been moved at all. Pure spaciousness is not dancing. It's silent. It's still. We never swept pure spaciousness up into any dance. It's still absolutely serene. This is what Ramana Maharshi was experiencing. The absolute, immeasurably vast serenity of pure spaciousness, of the ground of being of God, the self, as he called it, the true self, our true nature, the true nature of being. Now, all of this work I'm doing here is necessary due to this frantic gold fever, millennial gold fever that the world has. It's making it quite difficult. There's no doubt about it. All this false light, the play with false light, the dance of false light, thinking that there's some way to dance this dance that, you know, will sweep God up in the dance. And there's a way to dance, to win the dance. There's no dance contest with God. You know, we're dancing, but God isn't dancing. There's no contest. And there's no winning by default either. God still remains this pure spaciousness, a zero-dimensional pure spaciousness that is the ground of being of all that is. If the Eucharist is made a symbol of no glamour, then, you know, it's a helpful reinforcement. Let's everybody come to church. We'll drop all our glamour. And everybody come in very plain dress, very plain speech, humble heart, severely modest, in a mood of repentance. And let the food that we eat together as one family be this completely unleavened, modest wafer, you know. And that can help. That can the idea of eating food as a family together is also part of the Eucharist. That we are one family in Christ. What do families do? They dine together. So the church comes together to dine together on this deglamorized symbol of flesh. The flesh deglamorized as the Eucharist. And they say the body of Christ is in there. Well, Jesus said his body was his teachings, and his teachings did tell us to deglamorize the flesh. The flesh profiteth nothing. So in some way you could say they're eating the flesh of Jesus, because you're eating this symbol of deglamorization. You know, it's a spiritual body that you're eating, of an ideal of deglamorization. So they could say that the spirit of deglamorization, let that be with you. Let this be a reminder, you know. And of course, it's the old transubstantiation notion that you are what you eat. But this is really on a spiritual level, that this is a reminder. You are what you believe, you know, so to speak, but really, you can't change what you are. So stop trying. Stop trying to glamorize the flesh with all these fashions. Fashion industry, glamour industry. Massive, you know, when you're watching television, you're watching glamour industry. You're watching arrogance tell you that it has the winning strategy for you. watching movies. That's what you're watching. You think you're pursuing the winning strategy and are completely deluded about that. So again, the Christians are the ones that Jesus pointed out, you know, your strategy is a failure from the very beginning. It will never succeed. Total failure. Spirit can never be made flesh. It's impossible. So it's a losing strategy. No matter how you glamorize that flesh, spirit can never become flesh. It's not possible. Pure spaciousness never becomes the appearances that arise in it, so to speak. It's never caught up in the dance of appearances. It can never be caught up in the dance of appearances. And actually, all motion is an illusion. They're just a play of light, but everything is just pure spaciousness, actually. It's very root. Even all appearance is just pure spaciousness, and nothing more. So everything is God, actually. Everything is God. God can't become something different than God. It's not possible. They'll take the churches over and turn them into houses of fashion and have fashion shows in them. That's what they want. Absolutely. Ultimately, that's their goal, and don't think they won't do it. They'll say, we'll take away the taxes and status unless you allow us to put on fashion shows here. Use the altar as a catwalk. They'll put a raised catwalk in the height of the altar all the way down the aisle. They'll have all these models modeling all these glamorous fashions and glamorous looks, and they'll call that a service, you know, church service. That's their goal. You know, this absolutely. They'll jazz up the inside of the churches and outside of everything and glamorize it all. And they'll claim that's And any attempt to deny them is discrimination. Is discrimination. This is the millennial fever of the arrogant ones, who are still caught up in the logic of arrogance. They see this as the winning strategy. So of course they're going to pursue what they think is the winning strategy. But Christians know that Jesus pointed out that arrogance cannot win. There is no way to win. Fail. Arrogance is fail, period. And so we realize, wow, if we don't set this down, we're going to continue to be brutalized. We don't want that. So let's work on setting this down. And so they're very serious about it. Say, no nonsense here. And so, but they're under siege by the millennial generations who have millennial fever and believe that glamorizing the body is the way to succeed, way to happiness, which is absolute fail. It's the way to continued misery, suffering, and brutality is what it really is. Of course, body language is about, what, 90% of communication is body language, actually. So, circumscribe the body language, too. The way you walk, the way you gesture, the way you talk, all the body language, the way you posture, etc. The proximity and everything, the attitude of repentance and modesty, etc., has a whole body language with it also. Very important. You come down, you come, you sit quietly. You sit, you be prayerful. You're not there to be seen. You're not there to see or be seen. So coming to church is supposed to rehearse this, practice, practice, practice. And then this helps us more and more and more see through the delusions that we've, you know, that help us recognize what the winning hand really is, and stop following the false assertions and reassurances of arrogance, which is only producing losing, 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 misery, brutality, misery, sickness, death, suffering. It's all it constantly brings this upon us. We bring this upon ourselves through the logic of arrogance, because we can never succeed, and we have to keep trying to motivate ourselves. And we might say, well, I spent all my attention on these beautiful bodies and I'm so engrossed, but it just wasn't enough. And then we start applying the whip to us, you know, start brutalizing ourselves, thinking that this will motivate us to be even more attentive to bodies, even more engrossed in bodies. That the attraction didn't work, so now the whip has to be used. And so we ping pong back between, you know, fortune, misfortune, fortune, misfortune, fortune, misfortune. Constantly, this is this brutal play of existence. Brutal play of existence. Look at history. You see, it's a play of brutality. Of course, attraction there, but it never's enough, so the brutality always comes upon the scene. Always attraction, brutality, attraction, brutality, attraction, brutality. We're headed towards June right now, so once we get to June, we'll have about another year to abide in this, make our decision, another year to make our decision, to finish the decision process here. We have about a year to, right now it's about 13 months, to finish our decision process. Which way are we going to go? Are we going to continue to pursue our millennial fever, thinking that's the winning hand? Or are we going to decide to pursue repentance, setting down arrogance, and realizing we're dwelling in the timeless, placeless place right now? Timeless, placeless place. That's our identity. That's our truth. So about another, 13 months, to finalize our decision and get comfortable with it. So this is what we're doing here. Hopefully this is what Jesus will be doing, and finalizing our decision. Which way are we going to go? It's interesting. We don't want to make our bodies like too ugly, because it's something about seeing ugly bodies that horrifies us, and then we get attracted back to attractive bodies. It's better that bodies just kind of look like this sort of neutral, just look like a kind of light, the sort of a neutralness where it's just, you're not really attracted or put off one way or the other, just sort of like neutral. This is better. Yeah, I've noticed that. If you see some people are like looking very grotesque, and trying to appear glam or something, and they look grotesque, and you just go, oh God, that's so horrible. I can't stand that. Just so horrifying the way they look. And then you go frantically looking for beautiful bodies. So just get this reaction out of my mind. That's terrible. So again, don't try to make yourself look, hideous. It's okay if you just look neutral, not too attractive, not too unattractive, just kind of neutral. And then we can kind of say, okay, let's just focus on the content here of truth. It's like some senior citizen dressed in a bikini or something. It's just the skin is just all wrinkled and hanging from their bones, and they just look, just like everything's like, oh God, please no, I don't want to see that. It's terrible. It looks so hideous. And then you want to go looking for something attractive. Get this out of my mind. That's not the way. Middle way. Buddha said the middle way. Okay, middle way. Just let yourself be kind of this neutral, severely modest, neutral type of appearance. This works best. So this will help you in your decision. This helps. Monotones. Yeah. Soft tones, blacks, whites, beiges, just nothing like bright orange or red or something. It's all punchy and exciting, dull clothing. And again, middle of the road here, don't wear stuff that's all torn and jagged, and that's often used to accentuate wearing ugly, torn, ragged, chic accentuates then the body. You want something that looks smooth and tanned and nice, then you see that as a clever ploy by arrogance to glamorize the body. Wearing the rag chic, torn clothes chic, that kind of stuff. Now wear neat, presentable, neutral tone, neutral tailoring, neutral tone, neither looking too nice or too bad, neither one. So in appearance and demeanor and all this, middle path in appearance and demeanor. Speech, appearance, demeanor, neutral, middle path, neither this way or that way too much. And just so it's easy to settle down into the content of what's being focused on, easy to settle down into it. We're almost there here, almost at the end of this video. How about that? I'm always amazed that when I sit down, I say, how is it even possible to speak for 2.5 hours like this with full of content and new content? It just seems like, how's that even possible? Doesn't seem like I can't think of anything new to say, but as I make the effort, it keeps arising. The continued clarification and progress in this keeps arising. So we can assert, I'm already dwelling in the timeless, placeless place. I'm already dwelling in the timeless, placeless place. I'm already dwelling in the timeless, placeless place. I am already in the timeless, placeless place. I already am as the timeless, placeless place. I already am the timeless, placeless place. Yes, I already am the timeless, placeless place. I already am the timeless, placeless place. Yes, I already am the timeless, placeless place. Yes, I already am the timeless, placeless place. Yes, I already am the timeless, placeless place. Okay? Assert that. Yes, I already am the timeless, placeless place. already am the timeless, placeless place. I already am this. I already am this timeless, placeless place. I already am this timeless, placeless place. I already am this timeless, placeless place.